Welcome back. 75 more minutes to go. We're almost there.
That's right.
All right. Okay, so the last session we are looking at, we've gone from personal aspirations, we've done blue sky, anything possible, money is no object. Now we're back in the real world. Right. Money is, in fact, probably part of an object. There are only so many things that we can do. You don't have the perfect board. You don't have maybe all the buy-in from all of your staff to do everything that you would want to do. What can you do, right? So that's what we want to be talking about over the next 60 minutes or so, and then we're going to spend the last 15 minutes from 3:45 to 4 o'clock doing a little exercise together, and then we will send you on your way.
And the way we thought we would structure from now till quarter of four is we each have a few ideas coming out of things we've been hearing that are we think have practical applications, and we want to throw them out there and talk about them very briefly. And then basically anyone who has an idea that they can throw out there in 30 seconds, we're writing them down. These are all being transcribed, and this kind of becomes our list moving forward of things that we can do. And our stuff is based on what do we keep hearing as recurring themes. Mm-hmm. It all relates to this conversation about these three groups, but it suggests the places the work may want to go now. So something I heard over and over and over again was about space. So there's a whole conversation and piece of work that I think we maybe want to think about doing in terms of our buildings. And what that means is I think we've got to have a real conversation, and this is something all of us can do in our own places when we go home. We have to have a real conversation. It sounds really easy to say we need to make our theaters more open and welcoming to our communities. I love the PTA idea, and I'm scared to death. What happens if I schedule a PTA meeting in my theater at 5 o'clock on a Wednesday afternoon, and it's after opening, so everything's fine, and then an actor gets sick, and I actually have to do a put-in rehearsal at 5 o'clock on Wednesday afternoon? There's a lot of reasons that this is a challenge, but I think we can all go back and think about what are the things that keep us from opening up our buildings in a different kind of way. First I was saying, well, we have to talk to architects, and we have to talk to design people. No, we have to talk about what are the practical things that are getting in the way of us opening the doors of our theaters, our offices, our whatever, more frequently. So that's
do we want to respond to that in the room, or is that how we're doing? Yeah. Oh, hand.
Hi, I'm Brian.
A lot of us work in, I'm not saying I do, for those of you watching on live stream, work in a culture of no. So the knee-jerk reaction to ideas is immediately no, because what we do is we're like, oh shit, if we do that, then we have to do X, Y, and Z are really hard. We have to staff, we have to do this. We might have a put-in. We can't feel like, everything is sort of like a culture of no, and I feel like I guess the message that I have is to fight that. Like Adam was saying earlier about, you know, we need to empower ourselves to ask for what we need.
Oh, and I'm saying we should do spaces.
And what I'm saying is in organizations, there is this culture of no, because there are all the negative responses that why we shouldn't. And we, the idea makers, need to fight this culture of no and not allow no to be the first response.
But we have to acknowledge that some of the no's are there for a reason.
Right,
and
but
overcome.
No is the final answer,
no.
Not the first answer.
Well, and maybe it's not no, it's okay, but, and how we go forward.
And more thoughts on space. Yes, oh, yes.
As somebody who runs an organization with, you know, extremely limited resources, I would encourage everybody who, even those of you who work in really large institutions, to think about the $5 solution. I don't think that all of these things need to like be like, we need to reconvene with the architects and blah, blah, blah. Sometimes it's like, play some music, you know? You know, dim a light over there or put a gel on it or something. Or like, you know, I mean, there can be very small ways
to make a space.
To create a touch of hospitality. And they don't all have to be, you know, giant expensive gestures.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Did it more
space
on, yes.
Thought?
My theater company was in residence at the Factory Theater, and the Factory Theater closed. So this is less a space thought than a thought about bringing people, audiences, no matter what their economic level, into whatever space my company's performing in. So I decided not to say this during the pie in the sky part of the conversation. I do want to change our ticketing structure to be free up to $25. So if you're paying a dollar, you're still a donor to my company. That's my next experiment.
Great. Okay. So I was, we've heard a lot and we've been talking a lot about,
more
on space.
Yes.
Yeah, before we leave this topic. Go ahead.
To the culture of no, and I understand.
Oh yeah, go ahead.
I understand that, and I think where it's coming from is, you know, automatically saying no when there's an idea that's proposed, and I am someone who's proposed quite a few ideas, and they've gone nowhere, and we're all way overtaxed. Not only are we underpaid, but how many of us are exhausted perpetually? How many of us, partly we say no because we don't know how to say no enough, maybe. And and you know, how many of us playwrights say yes to more readings or productions that are all in a row, which doesn't allow us or each individual project to breathe. And so I guess, yes, we should say yes more, but we should also understand where the no is coming from, and I think have real compassion for each other as artists and administrators, because we're all kind of in the same boat, even if we're using different sides of our brain. And I'm wondering if, like, where it's leading me, this whole idea of space and no and all that, is how can we prioritize taking care of each other and ourselves? Mm-hmm. Because that is one of the first things to go out of the window when there are many, many grant deadlines and many, many rewrite deadlines, et cetera, et cetera.
Right. Cool. Any more on this topic before we go? Okay. So from the very beginning, we had a lot of talk around what it means to have a talk back versus a talk with. And I don't know that any of us knows exactly what that means. Maybe some of us are doing it. Maybe some of us haven't tried it. But I think we could all begin, right? And I think if you're a playwright, you could go in and ask and say, I really don't want to do the regular talk back. Could we do something that is more like talking with the audience, right? So I think all of us could do that, no matter what our role is to begin to model that. And someone said yesterday, as we were doing one of the panels, like, you know what, we really don't know how to do this because we're doing a talk back thing right now. So like, what does that mean even within our organizations to really begin to learn how to talk with each other instead of having these sort of top-down talk backs? That's my, yes. Will I stretch that far? No, where's the microphone?
I couldn't let Maria run all the way across the room and not use it. Okay. So when I was at Septon Wolf, we created a little manual for moderators. We had a post-show program where somebody got up in front of the audience after every performance of every play and had a conversation. We hadn't had any kind of, any real conversation about what the goals of those conversations were and best practices and strategies about achieving them. So when I took over the program, I did that. I did some thinking, and we created a little handbook for facilitators that I've since added to and had some with the assistance of Deb Piver at Center Theater Group. And that's something that I have that I would be happy to share with people if you email me. So. Real
there's
tools.
Something we can do. Great. Hand, other side of the room. Woo!
I don't really have any big ideas on that one, but I did just want to thank the playwrights who are here, especially Laura, who have been so eloquent about the way we can approach writers about participating in conversations with our audiences and encouraging us to approach artists without fear to participate and communicate and engage with us as well as our audiences. So that's all I had to say.
Great. Yeah.
I would say that
finding a way to create a structure in which it isn't talking heads to a group of people listening, fighting to maybe get in a way to speak, but in a way that allows the opportunity for everyone to at least turn to each other and speak, get into a small group of like three and four and speak, so that there is some sort of concrete way in which people are able to feel validated and heard that may then involve a structure like we saw brilliantly with Dog and Pony one time, where they had different structures of length of time of answers. So if you have a very short answer, we can answer it all as a group. If you have a longer answer, we're going to break up into four groups, and each you can just go to whatever question that you have that you want answered, and we can have a little mini conversation like that. So there's people that are doing really effective models of that type of conversation that would be super great to share out.
Right next to you.
This is a talk with idea for within an institution or organization. Mm-hmm. One thing we do is a staff retreat where the entire, now again, we're a smaller staff, but you can do this in pockets too. The entire staff will get together and read aloud with each other the plays that are being programmed or that are in contention for being programmed, and initiate a conversation led by dramaturgy around what are the challenges, what are the anxieties, what are the opportunities that these plays present for each department, so that everybody gets a chance to say their piece. And when a decision is made, it's informed by
That's
all of that.
Really cool. Over here.
I just came back from being in Berlin, and I saw two plays at the Schaubühne where they actually had their talkbacks two-thirds through the play, which was really, really fascinating because it would be right sort of at the climactic moment, and they would encourage the audience, and there were some lively debates about what they really thought should happen before the actual conclusion of the play came. It was really fascinating.
Okay, Jackie, you had something.
Oh, yes. So this is one of the dialogue, post-show dialogues that I really appreciate. So when I write a play, I'm very clear about the kind of conversations that I want to have with my audiences, and I do that in my blogs by interviewing the artists that are involved and asking them questions. And so one of my favorite things in these post-show conversations is bringing experts in the field onto the panel, so that I'm leading the conversation, so I'm actually asking them questions, digging in, because it becomes a great dramaturgy session for me, right? And it allows the ideas of the play to lead the conversation, and so that's one of the things I want to throw out there as an idea. It's been really productive for me.
Great. One over here.
Well, I will say I've had traditional talkbacks that were incredibly successful for certain plays, is kind of the what seems to me to be the important thing. So it seems like if we can curate or design an experience for interacting with the audience based on what that particular play needs, then we can perhaps be more successful with this rather than saying this is what our theater does for every single play.
Right, exactly. Mm-hmm.
This is a little diversion. I was inspired by what Liz said, and I think that funders especially are interested in how we can, especially for playwrights, like help them help us make a better living, like make a living. I think that part of it is just that I have actually met like upper level theater staff people who do not know how playwrights are paid. Raise your hands if you know how playwrights are paid. So a lot more people here than I thought, but still like a good 50% who don't. So we get paid 4 to 6% against royalties. At smaller theaters, that's 1,000, 2,500, 5,000, something like that. We are the only artists who make theater whose fee is directly tied to how many tickets are sold. Mm-hmm. However, we have no say over how they're sold, to whom they're sold, how much they're sold for. We have no control over any of it. The least I have made off of any play is $256. That's 6 weeks of performances. The most I have ever made is $11,000. The more typical figure is like, I don't know, $3,000, something like that. Like royalties, like $400, $700, something like that. So if we could come up with different financial structures that would say, playwright, you get a fee, not an advance, but you get a fee plus royalties. You get like a guaranteed higher fee that's more in like the 8,000, 10,000, 12,000, 15,000. I think Yale Rep is doing this now. But like you actually get a director's fee, twice a designer's fee, something like that. So you are actually guaranteed a larger percent of the budget than the actors or the director. Or I'm just saying.
Maybe on to the next idea.
Okay. We talked a lot about being in community. There's been a lot of conversation about being much more in community. But we haven't talked as much about what's the invitation to the community. In other words, we've talked a lot about being in community once people get to the door. We talked about, you know, reaching out, they're at the door, how do we get all these people are in our theater, but we need, I think, to do some work on how do we get the community, where's the invitation, right? Where is our invitation and what's the rationale for the invitation? Because if it's simply host a meeting, right, there's gotta be, so to have some, so that it comes from an authentic place within your organization. I mean, I love the idea about, you know, doing the play somewhere else, right? So how do we, when you pick, do we have to go out, how do we meet the community? Do we go out into the community? Do we perform out there? Do we go out, anyway, it's fine to talk about being in community, but we really have to think about how do we invite people in? So thoughts about invitation. There.
I think we start by defining our own communities beyond just the theater community. So, you know, Andrew takes a martial arts class once a week, and that's a really important, you know, when we talk about like being willing to say no to things, it's important that Andrew goes to his martial arts class as much as it is that he takes time at our theater to write a work or to come in and have a staff meeting, because that means that he exists beyond just being a theater artist, but also as a resident of San Francisco, as somebody who is engaging with the world beyond making plays. And then those people become people. Andrew has so many friends, and it's amazing that he keeps up, you know, these friendships with people way beyond. And that, as you know, we all do that. That we invite his martial arts class to come into the theater, and we invite, you know, you talked about, you know, going out and joining a temple, or like having just, I think existing in a world that isn't only about our work is a really basic but like super important way of engaging, of making community real. It's like let's be real people. And then this isn't gonna be so hard. I know we can all do that. We're gonna do that.
Over great. Here.
Since I'm sitting next to the mic. At Playwrights Foundation, one of the things we've started doing is talking to the playwrights before they come for our annual festival, and asking them who they want in their to show the play to. Who do they want to have hear the play and respond to the play? So we did that last summer for each of the playwrights, and we had some really great success and some not so great success with that, being new at it. So that was a way that Playwrights Foundation served each of our writers, and we'd like to continue that.
Moving down, there was a, it's
who's next? Hand. Speak.
Yeah, sorry. So this idea of going out and being like a real person and a real citizen, I think, is so important. So I was trying to buy tickets for a basketball game the other day, and I have like no idea how to do it. And I have no idea, I don't really know where TD Garden is, and I've lived here for like over a year, and I'm just like, I'm afraid of the whole sports thing, but I'm going, mainly because a bunch of gay people are going. But anyways, that's not the point. The point is that like, we are looking at our spaces and being like, how can they be more inviting? But like, how can we really know? Because how often are we going to spaces that aren't like somebody else's theater, right? Like, how often are we really going out of our comfort zone? And so something like that's super tangible, like on the ground, and that I'm trying to work on, and that people in my organization are really trying to work on, is that like, as we identify community partners, as we identify organizations that may work in completely different sectors, that are working with our same constituencies or working in a similar values proposition, like we have to go to their events. Like we have to be out at other people's things that are completely not theater related and see their dialogue around race equity happening in Hyde Park, or we have to go out more and we have to be present in their events if we can even begin to formulate an invitation for them to come to ours.
Over here.
I think one thing that we've been working on a lot is the being intentional about audience design and knowing who we want to have in the seats mm-hmm. based on the type of conversation that we want to have. But I think that is a super interesting notion to take, is who is it that we want to be experiencing this work, and how do we go about getting it? And as anyone who has maybe not done traditional, I'm just using the example of Latino theater, if you are a traditionally mainstream regional theater that, for example, does a play about Latino theater, that doesn't mean the Latinos are coming. So what is your personal investment in getting folks in the audience, and how do you go to community centers, and how do you reach out to people, and how do you make partners so that you can get those people, those ringleaders, to then mm-hmm. bring the folks that you want to have in the audience?
And can I just, to piggyback, just to say, how do you sustain that engagement beyond that one show, instead of, you know, doing a play about a particular community once every 24 months, like it's a comet or something, and only reaching out to that community at that point?
Yes. I want to follow up on that, because that was a back to the pie in the sky ideas. I mean, we have our community connections programs, and for every show, we've picked partners and worked with partners, and many partners continue from show to show, despite the if there was a topical interest or not in the next show, because of that welcoming factor. And I feel like it's we agree when we're working with a partner that you will have a representative at our theater alongside one of our representatives, and together we will welcome your constituents. And that's how we get meaningful practice. But what was my pie in the sky again? It's not that pie in the sky, but there's some community connections partners that we haven't been able to maintain, just because they, you know, it's a lot of work to maintain those relationships in a meaningful way over periods of years. And some are, you know, really proactive, and we're really proactive with them. So finding, again, collaboration with partners outside of our discipline is a phenomenal thing, but you have to have resources to maintain those relationships.
Over here. Yep. Anyone over here? Yeah, Lisa?
One, two. I think having worked with a lot of community partners, I think the last project that we did with the refugee community, and I think the most successful thing for me was going in with a list of things I thought we could do together, but not starting with that list, with asking them, okay, we're going to do this play that's about your community. What do you want out of it? What are your goals? What do you want to see? Do you want political action? And they came up, well, we want to have this petition because there's this thing in front of the legislature and we need people to know about it. So how can we work together to make that known? And I said, well, what I need is someone to put together a really concise page about what the issues are, because you're more knowledgeable about it than that. And between talking between all of us, we came up with what we could do together. And the group self-organized talkbacks after every show. Mm-hmm. One of them just took it on and said, I'll do it. I'll make sure someone's there every night. Cool. Great. Awesome. it's been really successful in having their buy-in in an upfront way from the beginning of thinking of the project to the readings, and then through the whole production process and afterwards, as we continue to be asked to be on host committees for benefit events and attend their events.
That's great. Is there anyone else?
Anybody else on this?
I just want to echo the understanding the challenges of the communities you're working with in attending your production. So like, is it show specific to a community that, you know, the single mother that's working two jobs and doesn't have time to go to the theater? Or is it, you know, how can we bridge those gaps and make it more available for everyone?
Oh, that's interesting. Okay. All right, so maybe on to another possible next due. We've been talking a lot about the third act has been something we've discussed over the last couple of days. We've heard of Lisa's party every night in her theater. And it seems like it is something we could be doing. You just were talking about there was a talk back every night, you know, organized by this other group that you were working with. What could you do every single time that you have a performance that extends the conversation and becomes a welcoming place for the audience to actually discuss and have a talk with at least themselves, and if not other artists in the room? Could that happen every single time you do a production?
Lisa has a party, but we've started doing just kind of children's theater post-show meet and greets with the audience on stage after every show. It's simple, it's effective. The actors stay for 10 or 15 minutes. The audience come down and talks to them. An actor welcomes them at the end of the show to come. We're going to hang out here on stage for a little while. Come and talk to us if you like. And everybody stays, takes pictures, talks to the actors, and then goes home feeling like they had a personal connection with the art on stage. Mm.
Very quick and very cheap, again, my watchwords. keep the bar open, maybe put a little bit of food out, make your, like, have your lobby active, yeah. Like any something to suggest that, like, you're allowed to, invited to, we'd like you to stay here, whether it's talking to us or talking to each other. But it's like, it's not over, get out.
Yeah. Jeremy.
Since we don't do, you know, full productions, but we do two performances for each of the workshops that we have going on in the season, we do drinks and food and stuff for everyone all mm-hmm. the time, and all the tickets are free. So we're kind of a different thing in that way, but I would just say that we start by asking the playwright what they want.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, what would you like? Some playwrights will say, I would like to ask the audience a couple of questions about my play. Can I do that? Mm-hmm. So that we're also not stopping that process if that's something they'd like. Just ask. They'll tell you. And then also, I think keeping the bar open is great. What usually ends up happening is playwrights most often will say, can we just all hang out, and actors, directors, the writer, whoever wants to be out there, just hangs out with the audience and mingle. And we hear feedback from all of the collaborating artists that are developing the work during that week, that they love it too, because there's zero wall, that everything is porous.
Yeah.
And we're only ever starting, and this is, again, it's a play development center, but we start every one of those, you know, sort of sharing moments by saying, this is an open rehearsal. Very different than everyone else, because it's not a producing theater, but for us it is, it's an open rehearsal, and we're really excited that you're here, and we're excited to learn everything together. So I think it's thinking about we, and then the act three for us is about saying to the playwright, what do you want?
Yeah. Right. Great.
And that's in the shift.
Yeah. No, I work for OSF, which is also totally weird. But one of the things with us is we're a destination theater, and so one of the things that I found really exciting and I've been trying to live up to is the idea of being an ambassador. Because the way it works is, you know, people are coming and they're coming to Ashland for 4 or 5 days at a time to see 7 or 8 plays, and maybe some of them go rafting and do nature-y things. But if I'm in the grocery store, if I'm at the Starbucks, or if somebody asks me for directions on the street, I can guess that the person sitting next to me is coming to my theater. And it's a little hard for me, because you'll be surprised, but I'm a little shy. But of being open to, like, just starting a conversation with someone who's seen one of the shows, whether it be one of the shows from my program or one of the Shakespeare's, and just sort of owning that ambassadorship. I wish that I had done more of that at the other theaters I worked at, which were sort of more regular regional theater-y kind of theaters, of just sort of being open and available to have that conversation, especially because OSF architecturally, like, we don't have that lobby. We have a big open space, but during the summer, it's like wicked hot. You don't want to be out there. And so where are you going to find the people, and where are the people going to find each other outside of their hotel rooms? And just sort of, it's fun to be a part of it.
Yeah. This is an observation. I've noticed that when I've gone to see plays in rural settings, one of the things that makes it really exciting for the audiences is, particularly if the actors, the playwright, the director are in town for 2 or 3 or 4 weeks, the people who live in the community bump into them at the supermarket or in the coffee shop Or when I went to Shepherdstown recently, I sat at a table next to a bunch of the stagehands for breakfast one morning and just gloriously eavesdropped on all of the production gossip, which was really great. And I have some dirt, no. But so that works really, that's kind of easy to create in a rural environment. You sort of have to because everybody's in the same boat. So how can theaters in, so I ask this as an open question, how can theaters in bigger places, how can they sort of capture some of that? How can they make connections between the artists in their daily lives and the audience members in their daily lives in the same community? Mm-hmm.
There were some hands over here. Yeah, Brian.
There you go. So this is really simple, easy, cheap, free. Something we've tried to do at the Brick. When we have events, to really, and this is kind of goes with the museum, the security guards sort of reframing that. To, you know, if you're a staff member, when we've had events at the Brick, like I try to tell everyone, you know, you're the host of this party. If you see someone like off in the corner by themselves, like go get them, like talk to them, be like, hey, what's up? Hey, I work here. Oh my God, like you came and saw the show. Like, and just start that conversation and then bring them. It's, you're a host. So you take them, you bring them to someone else you know, you get them talking, then you leave, rescue the next person. And then in literally 30 minutes, everyone is doing that themselves. They're like, oh, and then this, and they're, and everyone is becoming friends. It's so much fun. It's free, but it does take conscious effort on the part of you and the other people in the theater, your actors, whoever you want to involve in this. But if you say, you're a host, host this party with us, and if you have like 10 or 15 hosts who are going to people, saying hello, introducing themselves, it creates this amazing energy of warmth, and everyone will be happy. And it's just sad because I go to parties, and sometimes nobody's doing that, and everyone talks to their own little group of people, and they're horrible parties, and the best parties are always the ones where you met new people, you talked to new people, you had a great time, but it does require people being hosts. So be a host.
Interesting. Brian, you had something.
My theater participated in the intrinsic value survey a few years ago, and one of the things that we learned was that our audience members really liked to spend that time in the, I mean, we live in Los Angeles, so it's a car culture, and everybody's driving really far to get to the theater, and our audiences enjoyed that time in the car, ruminating on the play, and a lot of them responded that they spent a couple days thinking about it. So something I want to do, and if anybody is doing this, I'd love to talk to you about it, but sort of extend this idea of Act Three beyond the theater and maybe follow up. I get emails after I go to a play with like a thank you for coming, take this survey kind of thing, or buy tickets to the next show. And I'm thinking about why not follow up, not with promotion of the next thing, but maybe with like dramaturgical notes to help promote conversation and thought about the play so they're engaging with the material for, you know, a couple more days and therefore developing a, you know, a tighter relationship with the work and perhaps us.
That's great. Maybe we should move on.
Okay. Okay, next point.
Next point. And this isn't really a point, or it's kind of a point. I was gonna say when I prepped this list before the last session, that we talked a lot about generosity. The idea of being more generous is something that a lot of folks aspire to. And I'm not sure that we know what that means. And my sense was that, you know, we talk a lot about sometimes no because we're tired, and is being more generous another thing that we have to do that takes time? So how are we more generous? And then when Christian was talking, totally understanding what he was saying and agreeing with it, I suddenly thought, wait a minute, we've talked a lot about generosity, and we're also talking about increasing more ownership. And generosity and ownership, and how do those, it seems like there are two threads here, which is we've talked about letting the playwrights take stronger voices and have more ownership over how you deal with the audiences, and you're totally right. You're the only people in the whole investment engagement where it matters how many people buy tickets, right? So you've got to take more ownership over that, and you've got to own it, and the staff has, so there's all of that, but we also want to be more generous. And so the challenge is, how do we do, I think both things are important, and maybe they're not in conflict with each other, but it strikes me as one of those things that is less a something we can do right away, but more something we need to be aware of. I don't know. So I don't know if anyone has any thoughts about that. Over here, I guess.
Adam does.
I have a microphone.
Go ahead.
One thing, I think generosity also extends between companies. So like one thing we're trying to do with the new Play Alliance is we're making an app that's basically a rewards app that rewards people for going to new plays no matter whose company they're at. So the idea is that you're going to win a free ticket to the one you didn't go to, but maybe you go see 8 shows at different companies, but they're all new plays, and then you win one more. But that means everybody has to be generous in terms of, oh, we're not just doing our new show, but go see one at Speakeasy or the Huntington or whatever. Sure. And I think we can collaborate that way.
Yep.
So during lunch, the playwrights met. And so Tori, I'd really like you to be generous. What we want is we want one of these.
Just for you guys.
Yeah, just for us guys. We want one because then we could figure out what we need. We're not doing to help you guys, and also we could use one of these. We do it at New Dramatists, but it's only with the New Dramatists. Playwrights.
Is that cohort?
Yeah, that's all. But it would be great to do sort of a national one or like one from different places, small, big. Be great.
Yeah. And I just want to throw out the idea, yes. The idea that what you just posited as oppositional are in fact the same, ownership and generosity. When a playwright says, give me more ownership, what we're saying is use this as a resource.
Right.
Let me be a collaborator. When I come into the theater, I don't want to just collaborate with my director. I want to collaborate with the entire freaking thing. I want to be a theater maker, not just somebody makes little marks on paper that mm-hmm. you take away mm-hmm. from me. Mm-hmm. and that is generous. That mm-hmm. is not grabby. That is just the opposite.
Right.
Let me help you.
Right. And then we'll move over there.
Only playwrights are talking. This is the revolution.
Yeah, all right.
I think the key to generosity is generosity without equity doesn't make sense. It's super easy to be generous when you have a lot of resources. It's harder when you're really struggling to make ends meet. And part of the difficulty is we come into these spaces and we don't always feel comfortable acknowledging those power dynamics that are at play. Like, we're all here, like, all our ideas are equal, but some of us have a lot more resources than others. And that's just difficult, you know, but it requires some bravery from all of us, I think, on calling that out. And I think that what I would really love to see is this idea of ethical design moving up into this audience conversation, because the word audience member versus community member versus the person's name, that's an ethical distinction that you're making if you're calling someone an audience member or a community member or calling them by their name. And I think it's an ethical decision when you situate the playwright as exterior, as a third leg, rather than fully integrated into one of the leg. There are ethical decisions in every single aspect of what we do, and yet we don't often talk about any of the ethical ramifications of what we do. And my expectation is, at a time in our culture when companies like Zappos or Patagonia are getting a competitive edge by thinking about ethics in every single step of what they do, theaters will be much stronger if we put those ethical decisions at the forefront, and then we talk about them in a really inclusive way so people can call bullshit when we're claiming to be ethical, but we're really not.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Over here, Lisa.
Yeah, I really do also want to contribute to what you've all said here. Because, you know, full disclosure, I don't have to try to make a living as a playwright. I'm a tenured professor at a college. I'm playwright in residence. I made that choice 13 years ago after 9/11 to move here and not be a playwright freelance and adjuncting at NYU anymore. So that's given me a lot of freedom, and I'm very aware of it. I'm very aware of what it's offered me, and it's also given me the opportunity to relaunch my company and do any darn play I want to do, including my own. But for the playwrights here and all over the country who are trying to work, and when you really listen to the numbers as to what they're making out of any given show, you know, on a play they've probably been writing for 2 years at least, sometimes 1, 2 to 3, 4 years, they're making far less than, you know, workers, child workers in China. You know, if you go hour by hour. And, you know, granted, we've made that choice to be artists, and in this country, that is already a very marginalizing choice. But I do think that it needs to be spoken.
Well, just speaking really personally for a minute, and I don't mean this in an advertising way, but and don't listen, Michael, because you're in charge of this part, but anybody here who wants as many copies of Outrageous Fortune as you need to give to your board members or whoever else to help educate them, because when people read it after they call and say, well, this can't be right, and you take them through it, then it was a pretty good, it hasn't done, so anyway, that some of that stuff is out there. So anyway, there was, here.
And Lisa was
helping. Oh, Lisa, sorry, and then.
Just on the, on the notion of generosity, one of the things that's most valuable that we can be generous with is our time and is our attention and being a good listener to staff members and audience members. Also, I just want to state for the record that these parties that we have are not expensive. I mean, it's not a big financial investment, it's time. It's time and energy that we're investing, not cash, in order to have these parties. And if you think that's crazy, wait till you hear the other thing we do around generosity is for every single production, they run 5 to 7 weeks each, we create a gift, and every audience member is given this gift. So the gift is, it's a small gesture of hospitality intended to be given from one human being to another. It's given after the show. Whatever it is tied into the theme of the play. They're encouraged to take it with them. And my intention is for that object to deepen and lengthen their relationship with the work. So whatever it may be, and sometimes it's interactive, a piece of origami paper for Rajiv Joseph's Animals Out of Paper, for example. My hope is that a week later, they're like, oh, right, I'm going to make that heart with those instructions designed especially for me with that origami paper. And then they're thinking about the work. They're thinking about the play and how it impacted them. And it engages them once they even left the party. So anyway, it's a generous thing, and it doesn't cost that much money. It's have to be very innovative and creative with those gifts, clearly, because it's not a big budget line item, but I feel that it deepens their engagement.
What we got? One hand, and then we're going to... Two more. Okay.
Lisa?
Or more.
We've had two Lisas, which is why we've been
and
back
Amy
and forth.
Amy has her hand up, and yeah.
Who's that?
Go ahead.
Oh, okay. So this is kind of a pie in the sky, but also practical, maybe. I would love to see it be flipped that playwrights don't bring us plays. We become in conversation before the play is ever written about what we need to write, what matters to the community, and what we might have of mutual interest to each other that might be written, and have the theater commit to produce that project when it's an idea stage, before it's written, so that we're all on the same page and we all have ownership and the community has ownership beginning, and forget about sending me finished scripts. I want to be in from the beginning, and I want to commit from the beginning, and I want it to matter to everybody involved. And I think that that's something we can actually do.
Wow. Okay. Amy. You need a mic.
I just want to echo the revolution, the playwright revolution. I support the playwright revolution. I want to reiterate, even though there has been the most amazing book and study written about the plight of the American playwright, I think it's worth saying again in this room when we're talking about generosity, that does not very often extend to playwrights. It just doesn't. And that's why it's playwrights, theaters, and audiences. Really, we should just be saying theaters and audiences, but because playwrights are outside that in our culture, we have to say that now. So I know we have a lot of solutioning and solutions that we've all been working on, but I think I just wanted to underline that it's still very much in play.
Okay, one more, and then we're gonna move to our final thing.
Just quickly. So some of the coolest ideas that I've been hearing are all evening ideas that are happening when the audience is in the space. And how do we get the administrative staff, you know, in the lobby, in the theater with the people we actually are all talking about connecting with? And it just makes me wonder if the 9-to-5 model is just like wrong for the administrative theater staff. That, like, why isn't our workday just 12-to-8 or 12-to-10? So you could maybe like go to the grocery store and like take a shower in the morning. And then you would be more willing and less fatigued at the idea at staying at your theater late.
That's really interesting. Okay. So, one more, okay.
And it segues into ideas.
Yeah. I'm just thinking about generosity and resource. And in addition to the potential, you know, experiences that playwrights may design and create for an individual theater, it always occurs to me that the playwrights, as well as other artists, directors, and actors, are because they are peripatetic, because they work in such a variety of venues, they are actually incredible field resources. They know probably more about the field than most of us who work in administrative jobs within the theaters. And so it's just another sort of act of generosity in ways that we can use them as resources to the field. I mean, is there, you know, putting them on our board of directors? Are there ways that that is also helps, you know, change some of that stratification and engagement, and then by extension, audiences for a variety of the work that's created for the stage.
Okay, now we are moving into the final 15 minutes.
Are we, what time is it?
We have 15 minutes, but what we're gonna do next is, if you have more good ideas that
more revolutions,
either related to what we were talking about or completely unrelated, we're going to give you 30 seconds to talk about that. And then we'll get through as many of those 30 second or less idea bursts, and then we'll move into our final exercise.
Or maybe no one. No. Any ideas?
Now I just scared it out of you. Okay. 15, you get 30 seconds to say something really quick.
Okay, 30 seconds. I think there's so much awesome work happening all over the country, and I would love pie in the sky to have some sort of like indie theater exchange where like a play like can be in New York and then it can come up here to Boston, and then and we'd all like trade. So like your play is here and my play is here, and then we'll trade spaces and we'll trade plays, and like we could do that, you know, maybe East Coast, West Coast, like we could have like 3 or 4 of those, but like it would be great to like have these new plays. You know, you work so hard on them and then they're over, and I would love more life.
So I just want to discourage a simplistic linking between community and content. Due to the number of times I've been to see a play that's advertised as Asian content, I ended up thinking this is a play aimed at white people. It decodes the Asian experience for white people, which is fine. White people, you need your theater too. But just maybe think a little deeper about who the play is connected to rather than just necessarily the people who are on stage.
I would like to see like a buy one, get one ticketing policy. We were talking about this earlier, but in a pay it forward kind of model where if your ticket price is $120, I, the theater, will give you this ticket for $50 if you buy a second one for someone who can't afford it.
Okay. Just move the microphone.
This is a very small idea, but that I had sitting here. If your theater is producing, let's just say my play, there could be,
for instance,
which you're all invited to do. what if the audience members that are interested in my work in particular, like, oh, we like this play, we want to stay in touch with this. What if I get their email addresses? What if I create an email list that I blast out to, and then I say, this is another theater in your city, or this is my friend, this other Adam Bach is doing a play in your city, and if you like my work, you know, sorry,
love,
yeah, you'll be much. so much happier seeing Adam's play, you know, or, and, you know, and if the theater can facilitate help getting that list to me, then I can end up using that to help support the theater if they do my play again. I've then got the power of that audience in my hands, or, you know, spreading it around. Or,
30.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, my 30-second idea. So playwrights are going to have their own convening. I want to have a convening with the audiences. Gasp. Mm. So, like, what if we had, like, mini convenings, like, all over the country with all these different theaters? Let's go party with your audience and find out what they are. Let's have, like, two-day things where the audience, the community, audience and community can be the same thing because they are in the same room, and let's get talking with them.
I had this idea in our breakout earlier, but I have a couple world premieres in Chicago this spring, and so when I get home, I keep thinking of, like, how can I make good on my promise? How can I put my money where my mouth is and, like, do something for the theater? And I was like, well, I don't know if for the theater, but for the community, so I think I'm just going to, like, email all the playwrights I know who have world premieres in Chicago this spring so that we can sort of meet up and say, how can we help each other? How can we help the theaters? Can we do host nights for each other? Can we do a bingo card for new plays? Can we make pins and you're, like, collecting pins? Can we do, like, a reward system? How can we actually, as playwrights, be enhancing each other's production experiences?
Awesome. That's awesome.
That's awesome.
So I had an idea inspired by the sports comment and also by the audience who's spending an hour driving home. And it's something I would love to see as an audience member is, I'm addicted to podcasts, and I would love to listen to the pregame discussion instead of getting to the theater and then reading it in 10 minutes while I have a little bit of time. Probably someone already does this, but I would listen on my way there to a half an hour discussion, and then I could, you know, listen to a different discussion from your website and stream it on my walk or ride or drive home, and people who can't get to see the play would maybe listen to it, or they'd listen to it and be inspired to see the play, or if they missed it, they'd get that discussion. So using that podcast technology, I think, would be just deepening the engagement. And if someone already does that, I love you, and I want to listen to it.
In addition to fostering a spirit of generosity, I would say fostering a spirit of curiosity and individual curiosity in every single person in an organization, from the box office to volunteer ushers to house managers to whoever it is, so that every single person has their own curiosity and personal investment in whatever the work is. They can speak about it. They can have face-to-face interactions with the audience, so that no matter who is representing the work, everybody is working to continue this dialogue with whoever's in the audience.
This is just as a, I guess, the only journalist in the room, or like the one who makes his full-time living as a journalist, I would love to see something be created by people within this community that exists online that allows us to talk about the theater the way really cool websites talk about TV, so that we can create a space not just for ourselves, but for audiences to come and be relaxed like we're at a bar, but talking deeply and with humor about the theater, so that we can remind people that it's okay to be a fan of theater and have, like, irreverent conversations about it that don't sacrifice in any way the intelligence or passion behind the work.
Ben?
Nice.
You've got two over here. Oh, sorry. just to piggyback on what Mark and Liz said, I think that there are some artists, playwrights in particular, who are doing exactly what Liz suggested, but they're doing it through social media, through Twitter in particular, Christopher Diaz or Lin-Manuel Miranda, who make their sort of Twitter experiences into a kind of performance in itself, but at the same time are engaging actively with huge audiences. So my question is, can theaters, in addition to curating the experience of coming to the theater and seeing all these wonderful different plays, can they devote a little bit of time to helping curate a social media experience for their audiences, so that their audiences know sort of who to follow and what to experience, and help connect to Mark's aspirational online presence for discussion of fabulous new plays?
Just one thing for theaters that want to work with playwrights who better understand their audiences, and that's, you know, be sure to, I think theaters have a chance to invite playwrights in early to get to know their audiences. So when you're doing all this audience development work and stuff, give your identified playwrights that you want to work with free tickets for a season, two seasons, and have them come listen to your post-show discussions so that they know who your audience are already. I mean, the Huntington kind of does this with their Huntington Playwriting Fellows, is they keep giving us tickets even though we're not fellows anymore, and we keep coming, and we keep getting to know their audiences, and then they might work with us someday, but it doesn't cost you much as a theater, but the writers you want to work with know, can learn who your audiences are and can write more effectively for you.
Over here.
I would just love to see somebody pilot this in-house childcare idea. Mm. What if you called the theater to book a ticket and the audience service person asks you, will you be needing childcare that night? And you pay whatever little extra that takes, and then you look at how many have registered for the evening and get whoever, you know, intern or people who are usually ushering to take on that role, and then the kids like can run around the rehearsal hall. That would be cool.
I'll go, since I have the microphone in my hand. Obviously, we've been talking for a really long time, not necessarily here this weekend, but in general about diversity issues with actors and playwrights and whatnot, and something that I think we don't talk a lot about is the lack of diversity in designers, because you don't see them, so you don't really know, and there are just as many problems in that department, and I wish we had a strong focus on that.
And you have the microphone next.
Yeah, I just want to add on that the childcare concept, I'd really, really rather people be producing and making more work that families can come to together. And I'm not talking about children's theater specifically, I'm talking about attending the theater with your family. And I know at the ART, we've done some productions that have been geared towards families. We didn't do that intentionally, but the experience in the space and the way those families continue to engage with the theater, and that we're talking about age ranges from when I bring my own children who are under 5, and then all the way up through teenagers and beyond, that is how people socialize. So everything we're talking about, like, why do people go to the theater, is to have this experience with people that they love, and they, whether that's friends or family, made family, et cetera. So please.
No, Joy? He's gonna
I have the microphone. hip-hop. I think hip-hop has been the most popular form of music in America for over a decade now, or it's been inspiring music, and how many theaters have been doing hip-hop theater. It's a really effective way of storytelling. So I think it's something that we can embrace and see what happens with new audiences that we can bring out.
Hi there. So I just wanted to respond that about the designer question, the designers of color, the Production Management Forum, they have launched a diversity, inclusion, and equity initiative, and we're about to post on the TCG Diversity Inclusion blog salon that Gus and I work with Davina's great vision to curate. So you're going to learn more about the amazing work that they're doing to do just that, bring attention and awareness to the needs of designers of color. I just wanted to share that information. Good. All of you are also welcome to contact me about being on the blog, because my favorite thing in the world is to uplift the voices of the individual artists in our American theater.
Uh-huh. Woohoo!
Okay, we've got maybe two more, and then we need to move on to the next thing.
Well, this could be a topic of conversation at the upcoming Playwrights Revolution Forum.
awesome.
But, you know...
I can't wait to tell the board.
In the coming revolution, surely some theaters will be spared, probably some here, because there are some really amazing theaters here who make life so much better for playwrights, right? And I feel like if we could start talking about what it is specifically that makes those theaters such an amazing place to be a playwright at, and then kind of be like, here's what it looks like. And maybe there's even like, there's an award ceremony every year where it's like, great news, theaters, you've won the It Doesn't Suck to Work at You for a Playwright award. You know, it's like positive social pressure can actually do a lot.
Almost on that thought. One more. Anyone else? One more great idea.
Yeah, over here.
I guess my argument would be, we are a really awesome group of people, I'll say. I enjoyed spending time with all of you. And we're all working in engagement and audiences and playwrights and making connections. And if you look around this room, a lot of us look the same. And I think if we are working in our theaters, around engagement with audiences. It is our responsibility to make sure those rooms that we are talking to at our theaters and with our communities do not look like this room.
Sorry, and that also that your discussion leaders have to, like, I'm super aware of how white I am and that I am not the right voice to lead every discussion. Right. So.
All right, moving on to the final exercise, which Tori will explain to you.
So I just want to say that I think San Francisco is equally, if not more, revolutionary than New York. So we could do it, you know. Anyway, I'm just kidding. We'll do it. You're all going to get a card. And on the front of the card, which is the unlined side, put your name and your address. This is your snail mail address. And on the line side of the card, we have two prompts for you. One, the first prompt is, thank you. The first prompt is, what's your biggest takeaway from the last day and a half? And the second prompt is, if there's any one thing you're going to do, you're thinking of doing differently, maybe there's nothing, maybe there's three or four things out of this, jot that down, and write yourself the answer to those two prompts. And then we're going to collect them, and we're going to do two things with them. The first thing we're going to do is they will actually be a kind of, they'll help us glean some data for an executive summary of the final report about what were the, and then we're going to mail them back to you in about a month. And you can see. So, yep, the prompts again are, first is name and address on the front, and then the second is a note to yourself. This is a letter to yourself or a paragraph to yourself. What's your biggest takeaway from the last day and a half? And with respect to the convening and the topic, what's the biggest takeaway? And is there one, are there any couple things you are going to do differently when you go back from whence you came?
And what should they do with them when they're done?
Jamie, what do they do with them when they're done? Should we just put them on the table? Do we have a box? Do we want to... Yeah. Just put them over here.
All right. Okay. I'll put it in my own words, and we'll see if this lands. Okay, so first of all, you address the note to yourself on the side that has no lines at all, the blank side. On the side that does have lines, where it is more easily to write, sort of in a legible manner, write two things. First, your biggest takeaway, your personal biggest takeaway from the last day and a half. Maybe one. Number two, what you are going to do differently to forward this work when you get back. And then we will, that's all you have to do. And then deposit it on the table. Then what we're going to do is collect all of that. We will record that so that we have a sense of what are the things that people took away from the day and a half, and what are the things that people are saying they're actually going to do differently to forward this work at home. So we want to collect all of that so that we know. And then we're going to mail these postcards back to you so you can remember. We don't know. They're not going to be unhappy if you share it with your organization. We just don't know that we can make it like open to the public at this point.
Yeah, I mean.
Sure.
And I think it really is actually in a good way. We'll get back to some of those are things that writers wrote, and I just before we sent them out to the world. I just want to check with the playwrights or whoever, you know, I just want to talk to them and make sure that they don't have a problem with it. So I think we can, I think we can do that. I think it's just a little bit of housekeeping.
Yeah. Yeah. Very funny things we're going to do when we get home.
Pass your cards down in this direction toward me.
Oh, he's getting a box. Okay.
We'll get a box.
All right, before people kind of slowly start filtering away, we do just want to say thank you one more time, first to all of you for being here. This has really been an amazing time. We were hoping it would be engaged. We were hoping this would be a think tank. We were hoping we would land in a different place than where we started, and I think all of those things happened, and they happened because you were here and because you were so incredibly engaged, so thank you. We definitely want to thank HowlRound and Polly Carl and Jamie and David Dower.
Can everyone stand up from HowlRound so we can thank you? All the HowlRound folks.
And Vijay and everyone at HowlRound.
And we should, of course, thank the Duke Foundation for doing this. Ben has been a great supporter of this, and there are some individuals also who have helped support this, and I have to just say that I wrote to some folks in New York, and I know we often are cynical about the commercial theater, but actually several of the folks who do a lot of producing of new plays supported this project because they wanted to see it happen. Thank you to everyone who has supported it and been generous in all sorts of ways. So, thank you.
It's already been done. It's been broadcast coast to coast.
That's that HowlRound. Thank you all.
Thank you, Vijay.
So leave us your cards.
Yeah. Keep those cards and letters coming.
And travel safe.